to ban. Radiant team ban. Complexities turn to ban. Radiant team pick. Complexities turn to pick. Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
Invoker.
Complexities turn to pick. Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
Bang.
Radiant team pick.
Hello and welcome back to the English coverage of the Shanghai Major Qualifiers. This is the NA region, being a best of two here between Team Freedom and Complexity Gaming. I will be your caster, Android. I'm being joined, of course, by @TedCast. How you doing, Ted?
I'm doing fantastic tonight. It's going to be a fantastic series of games. Team Freedom taking on Complexity. I know we had a couple of really nice NA games yesterday to cast, but today it should be even better. Both of these teams quite the favorites now, and each one of them, you know, has a chance of moving on to the qualifiers and, hell, making it any further in the actual event. So looking forward to seeing these guys play, and we'll see who actually comes out on top.
Yeah, obviously we're going to start out with some very typical drafts, especially for NA. We got the Abaddon picked up on Team Freedom. IX Mike, probably going to be snapping that up. Definitely one of his favorites to play, and boy does he play it so well. But Complexity, they get two of the strongest meta heroes right now. They pick up the Invoker and the Bane. I'm surprised neither of those got banned out first. What's your take on that? Do you think Complexity, are they just going to win with the meta on their side, or is this going to come down to playing?
Can never count on the meta like that. And of course, you pick up two incredibly strong heroes, so already you're feeling good. But the problem that Invoker and Bane are going to face right now is, yeah, they're very strong heroes, but if you don't draft around them well, you can end up putting yourself into a corner by getting them first, because that leaves Team Freedom to try to play against it in a much more effective style. So when you've got the Invoker, sure, it's like not exactly obvious how you play against it, but the problem with the hero is that he's super slow in lane. He takes a little bit to get started, isn't as OP level 1 with the Alacrity nerf early on. So yeah, he's still strong, but you get a lot of pressure on him early, then you should be able to cut his farming speed and make the hero a moot point for a majority of the game. Bane is not really in a similar story. The way that you kind of play around him is you don't give him anything. main player can easily in the early game find kills with his brain sap, go up, get a nightmare off, and set something up for the rest of his team. And Nightmare of Sunstrike is going to be an insane combo to watch out for, by the way. Fiend's gripped into that as well. But the point being, though, is that you just can't give the Bane anything in lane, and you got to put a whole lot of pressure on the Invoker. And if Team Freedom can accomplish that, then sure, you've got two strong heroes, but there's ways to play against them.
Yeah, absolutely. Again, I think it's just going to come down to the absolute playing of these drafts, because both teams really, really well done here. NA, obviously, going in, Complexity, I think, was definitely the favorite to qualify for NA. They had a pretty clean qualifiers run, and now they're in the tiebreaker here. They need to take games against Team Freedom to make sure they make it to the Shanghai Major.
10 seconds. Yeah, and Team Freedom, they've been playing pretty well up to this point as well. I mean, didn't they come in through the first open qualifier?
Yes, I believe so. I actually was following EU, so I didn't get too much of a taste of NA Dota, but I believe that is the correct path for them.
Yeah, and I mean, it was a pretty good run by them, and they show that they are a really strong team, so I wouldn't be surprised that they put up a strong showing. I'm not quite seeing where their draft is going right now. I mean, Abaddon and Slardar are two very good aggressive offlaners, or typically known as, rather, but neither one of them is completing of a draft on their own, and together they kind of butt heads a little bit. But with the Witch Doctor coming out, it makes me want to believe that they're going to go full aggressive tri-lane, because Abaddon and Witch Doctor are just impossible to play against in lane. I mean, and on their own, they're impossible, but together it's like you're a suicide lane. So pairing that with a Slardar could be effective, and then they run two more solo laners to go after this, but there's a little bit of innate flexibility they've got. They just have to make sure that the Slardar and Abaddon don't end up, as I said, mudding heads and killing each other's farm and limiting each other's effectiveness, because that can really easily happen if you're not entirely careful.
Yeah, absolutely. You make a really nice point there. The two heroes filling a similar niche, but the times I've seen IX Mike pick up the Abaddon, he just goes full survivability, absolutely throwing caution to the wind, charging into every fight, having his ultimate ready to go, which is obviously one of the best survival tactics in the game. Just, you know, you're going to do damage to me, I'm going to get back to full health and smack you right down. So Team Freedom, they've got some more flexibility in the draft. They need to pick up a mid, and let's see what else they're going to go for here. They could run the Slardar in a peculiar positioning, because I don't think he'll be going offlane.
As I said, if he does go offlane, it's going to be something like an aggressive try, but I'm not going to put too much stock into that one just yet. I want to see what their other heroes are going to be. The Phaseless Void is a really interesting pickup here for Complexity. It's going to, I think, be the non-core, you know, or core, but not safe lane farmer Void, so probably an offlane or solo save, whatever they depend to do. But it's going to be a cool one to watch, because Slardar and Abaddon both kind of make use of their low cooldown spells and teamfights, and Time Dilation will figuratively put a stick in the spokes of that, just keep it from getting too much of a problem. But I love this pick from Team Freedom, and I hate it at the same time. I love it because that's exactly what you need against an Invoker, someone who can constantly put pressure on him in the lane. I hate it because it falls under this, who's actually going to be playing the solo laner, who's actually going to be playing the carry, this kind of style, where the Slardar, Abaddon, and Spiritbreaker, all three of them I've been known to play in an offlane role, but only one of them can take that true solo offlane or dual offlane to heart. Otherwise, it's just kind of a weird laning setup that Team Freedom have got so far.
Yeah, they're definitely going for that big chunky melee heroes that just get and smack you, follow you around. It's really hard to dodge them, but Complexity, they're playing a very patient game here. They've got the Faceless Void, looking to just kind of sit on his own solo, trying to hold his own here. The Time Walk obviously being fantastic for negating any damage done to him. Ancient Apparition, gonna have a slow start, needs to get the Midas, needs to get the levels, but once that ultimate's out, Complexity, they've got some sick teamfight and amazing lockdown. Team Freedom, they're looking to get their heroes off the ground before that happens.
It's easier for Team Freedom to get their heroes off the ground, I think, than Complexity. Ancient Apparition and Void have a notoriously hard time in lane. But I guess the new Void a little bit less so, and Invoker might be able to help them out if he's able to have a free lane himself. But Team Freedom, they're just a couple of heroes that can do a lot with the very few items. So all they need is experience, and they can try to snowball from there, and the items will flow in as a result. But I'm looking to see what they grab, and they're going to have to grab a really greedy mid laner if they want to take this one late. Otherwise, they've got to grab someone who can fight from the get-go, or at least fight early on, and then try to end this game very quick. So something like maybe a Dragon Knight would be on their list of things to grab, or along those lines. Melee hero, maybe not so much, but I guess Dragon kind of switches between. Windrunner could be very good. She is pretty good against the Invoker as well. I could see that definitely becoming a thing here. The issue that Windrunner faces is that she can be pretty squishy, and if you get her with the Nightmare and then you chain off, you know, the Sunstrike and the Ice Blast on top of it, she has very little to survive through it. But then again, there are very few heroes that can do it. This is an interesting one. I mean, you've got a lot of physical damage coming out from Team Freedom, so why not grab a Vengeful Spirit to sort of act as either a carry or a support, whatever, but buff up the physical damage roll? And I don't know. I'm kind of iffy going into this draft, because again, it relies so much on being able to grab the early game and exert a lot of pressure really quickly. But if they can make it work, it's going to be a fantastic game to watch, because Team Freedom will just take control and they won't let anything go.
Yeah, just in the drafting phase, I'm really favoring complexity. I think they're playing a secure draft. They've got really nice lockdown for the early game. They've got the Bane. They've got the Invoker. Towards the mid game, Ancient Apparition going to be coming online with some crazy ults. And in the late game, obviously, the Wraith King is going to get monstrous. So Team Freedom, they're playing a risky game here, but it might end up paying off. Like you said, if they get any sort of lead before the 15-20 minute mark, it is absolutely in their hands.
And just to be sure, there's no camera bugs this time around, right?
No camera bugs. We're good.
Sweet. So I don't have to try being a broadcaster again. All right. But no, I completely, it's 100% agree. It's Z-Freak, Ancient Apparition, known for being a fairly weakly support unless he's got another support to help him out. And Bane will offer that. I think this is going to make sure that the Ancient Apparition will be able to get those cold feats off because of the Nightmare setting it up. And that combination, by the way, is going to be absolutely dirty in lane. But that's given they can find someone to put it on, and I'm not sure Complexity Mischief are gonna give them that position, as they're gonna group up and go for Complexity's jungle. Oh boy, they're gonna find Z-Freak
here, gonna be taking some damage. He knows he's in a whole heap of trouble. Venge taking the magic missile right to the face. Z-Freak going in, and that's gonna be the first blood, and now Sunbee is gonna secure that. So Venge obviously off to a great start so far.
Oh man,
essential here.
That Slytherin crush was a little sad, but I guess it was more to send a message, right?
I think it was just the pile drive of spells going home.
Yeah. That was a very nice first blood for Mischief. Now, of course, first blood, especially in a support, doesn't really mean all that much, but it's still about getting that 400 gold, you know, that nice little bounty, and then securing this area for the rune. In fact, they might grab both runes here, as Kiko is going to get it on bottom. Yeah, and somebody's going to get it on top.
There's something like an absurd, like 75-76% win rate if you get both runes at the beginning of the game, so it looks like Team Freedom definitely starting off on the right foot here, and now Faceless Void gonna be harassed, doesn't choose to skill up anything yet, probably gonna go for that time walk because it makes him just unbelievably survive.
Yeah, and it looks like Mischief are gonna run this as dual lanes, which is going to be very nice, because Abaddon, if he just sits behind the Spearbreaker can farm nearly freely, and if they decide to put anything on him, then Abaddon can come back and throw the Aphotic Shield. But if he gets caught alone, he could be in a bit of trouble. Looks like they're just going to throw some odd harass here, but they really have no more follow-up than that. Nyx Mike, yeah, there's the Aphotic, and they'll turn around. Bit of a pause coming out. Looks like we just need a sec. No problem. In the end, though, again, Mischief have a team that from minute one are going to be super aggressive, and they show it. They get first blood. They get first both runes. Let's see if they can keep the aggression going.
Sorry for the shoddy camera work at the moment. I'm having serious mouse problems trying to get that sorted out. There we go. That is so much better. And here in the bottom lane, going to be some rumble, but it's just going to be Mineski and Boy, we're going to call him, trying to be doing what he can to get himself ahead in the farm early on. In terms of last hits, top lane, we got a skirmish. There's going to be a Wraith King stun going here onto Kiko. He's going to be just fine.
Yeah, I mean, that's, again, he throws a Wraith Fire Blast out, but immediately Ix Mike is like, nope, you're not killing my Spirit Breaker. throws the aphotic shield down, and well, that's the end of that. So although it can't be as aggressive as the lane wants to be, it still is incredibly defensive. They will be able to find their farm, and I'd be surprised if the first actual laning kill happens in this lane just because of how defensive these guys can play.
Yeah, I totally agree. Let's talk a little bit about the mid matchup. We've got a mid Vengeful Spirit here up against Chessie on the Invoker. Definitely not something I'm used to seeing, but we're gonna see it run here by Sunbee, who's obviously a super competent mid laner. I've watched this guy all throughout the quals, and plays dirty, definitely super aggressive. His Ember Spirit stands out as just unbelievably clutch playing.
I think this lane really comes down to how many times Kiko actually ganks it. Because Sunbee, he's a great hero, but his kill potential alone is little to none. So he needs to have someone come in so that he can drop a stun to follow up, and then they go for the kill. And it looks like that's what's going to happen. The charge should connect. The stun coming in first. They're going to TP in the Bane, though. This could protect him. No, maybe not. The Nightmare comes through, but Sunbee's still attacking. Needs one more right click, but can't find the vision. They'll turn and maybe bring down Hanskin, the Bash, plus the double damage. Might secure it, but once again, the vision is playing their bigger enemy. And they will lose both of those kills, though. Kiko, he's waiting.
Kiko wants to go in Invoker. You might be playing a dangerous game here. Spiritbreaker wanting to go in so desperately. He does have the charge up if he wants to just charge in here, but Chessie gonna be hugging tower pretty tight. Sunbee going in. Magic Missile here committed. There's gonna be the charge there on the Bane. Brain Sap might not bring him up far enough. Magic Meatball, though, going through. Sunbee taking some damage. Does have the bottle. Chessie continuing to aggress. One more hit on the Spiritbreaker would have secured that. Going for the Sunstrike. Not quite on the mark there. And Abaddon actually ends up going down here in the top lane as Limp able to secure his first kill of the game. I think that was just a case of IX Mike playing just a little bit too YOLO.
Yeah. The Abaddon's really good at saving others, not quite himself. So once Kiko leaves that lane, IX Mike either has to go full on underneath his tier 1 tower, or if not, just hanging really far back, which is really hard to do because Wraithfire Blast is a nice
bottom
range.
Bottom lane here. Oh, Swindle's getting out just fine as that time walk is super broken.
broken smoking. It's pretty powerful.
Limp
charge
here,
gonna
be taking some harass,
top
charge
lane.
Connecting. Now, IX Mike does have the shield and just the Curse of Avernus, so no Mist Coil to come, and now there's gonna be a salve up onto Limp. Gets cancelled in by the breaking of IX Mike's shield, but he might be going down. Tower of Aggro is just too strong, and now there's gonna be a Nightmare here onto the Spirit Breaker. Waiting very patiently. He's gonna charge towards the mid lane, and I think he's gonna get out just fine here.
Yeah, Limp waited on the Wraithfire Blast, which was a huge mistake on his part. I think he expected he'd be able to get it off no matter what, but honestly, I don't know why they waited at all. They probably could have just done it immediately after the Nightmare and would have gotten the kill anyway. Chessie could be in trouble in mid.
Yeah, there's going to be a charge connecting. I think that is a super dead Invoker. Just a couple more bops to finish it off, and Spiritbreaker finally securing a kill for that, so now he's 1-0-2. That's a pretty nice KDA to have at 4 minutes in the game.
Yeah, it's great. The issue, though, I think with Mischief is that the score is 3-2, and don't get me wrong, they're ahead on kills, but the fact that they've lost two in the process, that's nowhere near the goals they were setting here. I think as the draft was going on, they're like, guys, 10 minutes are going to roll around and we better be, you know, 8-1 or 10-1 or even 5-1 or something. Like, you allow for one kill because it's going to organically happen at some points. Typically, you aim for zero, but again, you just, there's some things you can't account for. In the end, though, I mean, they've already lost two kills and are poised to lose more if they keep playing in the same style. But I think they're going to go back to the drawing board a little bit, try to tighten things up and maybe come back as a more cohesive team, and we'll see if that ends up working out for them, as Hanskin looks like he wants to make a gank happen in mid.
Yeah, he's trying for it real hard. We see here there's a Bane going in. He's only level 4. He does have 2 points in the Nightmare and the Brain Sap, desperately waiting on that level 6. That'll help him out a lot, but there's going to be a TP out from the Vengeful Spirit. They're going to be going in top here. There's going to be a charge committed onto Limp. He does have that Wraithfire Blast if he needs to use it. Going to just be taking the charge under tower, but Radiant might be getting a little bit greedy here. Looks like it's going to go an easy kill there. Vengeful Spirit killing off the Wraith King, and now looks like Ancient Apparition going to be taking out the Spirit Breaker. Z-Freak, that Chilling Touch still cast on him, as well as Hanskin. IX Mike using that Photic Shield once again, dishing out some nice damage. Another Magic Missile connects. That's going to be a dead Bane. IX Mike still surviving. Nice 2-for-1 trade, and I think that'll be a clean disengage there. 14 freedom.
Yeah, and Fun was really looking for the good bounce there on the paralyzing cask, but couldn't find it. They really wanted to go for another one on Z-Freak, and that was a 1-for-2 trade, which is not bad, but again, it kind of goes back to they really don't want to be losing anyone. Now, it was a brilliantly placed Sunstrike. They were able to get the return kill off onto, I think it was, what, the Slardar? Or the Spiritbreaker, sorry, as a result, but in the end, again, they're not quite pulling ahead as fast in the kills, and they've got to tighten things up a little bit more just to be sure that, yeah, they find these kills, and it was a great trade for them, but they don't want them to be trades. They want them to be straight-up massacres.
Absolutely. Like you said, their draft depends so much on getting an early advantage and just continuing to push it and shove it until complexity is turtling and hiding and dared to go anywhere on the map, but that's not the case just yet. Here we're going to see some more initiation perhaps coming out. There's going to be a haste advent, throwing out the magic missile. Z-Freak in some serious trouble. There's going to be a Sunstrike, however. IX Mike getting very, very low. Does he have a shield? He does. He's going to try to run for it, but there's the Chrono committed. First Chrono of the game. Super easy kill secured onto Swindles. Boon fed for him, but now looks like Vengeful Spirit might punish him. There's the 17%, but he's gonna time walk back under tower, and I think Radiant just have to leave this one be.
I think my favorite part about that was not the Chronosphere, but the fact that Faceless Void immediately attacked IX Mike and then popped his aphotic shield, which then killed Limp. So that was probably the biggest misplay he could have made there, because Limp was alive if he had just waited to attack for a short second or two, but he gets greedy, goes for the kill immediately, and kills his own buddy in the process. Not really what they wanted out of that one, and again, a little bit more worth it for Mischief, but still trading away kills, you know, broken record at this point.
Oh, here we're gonna go mid. Looks like Invoker taking a stun. I don't know if there's follow-up here. Gonna be a swap committed, magic missile as well. Chessie getting very, very low, but Bane's here, wants to save the day. Looks like not quite in time as Vengeful Spirit gets the kill. Nightmare transferred off as Sunbee. Now they go back to farming and perhaps chasing the Bane. Another magic missile. She's under tower though. How tanky is this Vengeful Spirit? Well, it looks like we're gonna see the answer here. She survives this double tower siege going in. And Sunbee getting a double kill here. That is a 5-0-4 Vengeful Spirit at 8 minutes in the game. I was a little bit skeptical about a mid-Vengeful Spirit. I am no longer skeptical about a mid-Vengeful Spirit, my goodness. Oh, here we go, charge onto Limp. And that's gonna be a chilling touch. I don't think that's saving his life here. He's not level 6. Goodbye, Wraith King. But now it looks like there might be a trade here. Spiritbreaker consumes a fairy fire. He de-aggroes the tower. There's gonna be a Sunstrike off the mark though. Hanskin gonna be taking that nether bash, and now it looks like, ooh, there's gonna be a nightmare there. And okay, Bane goes down. Spiritbreaker just fine. That actually protected him a little bit.
I think it was a misclick. He went to attack and ended up taking off the nightmare instead.
Well, either way, it was a nice clean trade for the Radiant.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what they need. Team Freedom, they're getting an advantage here. Looking at the net worth chart, it is slowly but steadily growing in their favor. About 4,000 net worth, it's more gold in their pockets, and 3,000 XP. So more levels for their supports and their cores.
Yeah, I mean, it's getting very near a 500 GPM advantage right now for Team Mischief, and that's exactly what they wanted. And that wasn't a trade at all. Like, they got the kill in mid, a couple of kills in mid, and then they went top, got the kills up top without losing a single hero. So that's exactly what they want out of this one. They go in, they go ham, they use their defensive and their sustainable spells, or their sustained spells, rather. They are sustainable, though. And keep their guys alive while they just dive tower like that. And though there are some hiccups every now and then, it still ends up working out in their favor.
Oh, hold that thought, mid lane. There's going to be a nightmare here onto Fun. Looks like he's going to be taking a Sunstrike. Invoker, nice easy kill there. And Vengeful Spirit just going in, trying to harass them back. But here in the top lane, we got a dive. There's a charge here connecting onto Swindles. But oh, the Chrono takes out any damage. IX Mike using that Curse of Avernus. But now, might not be so lucky. Limp TP's in. Wraithfire Blast connects, doing some serious damage to the Faceless Void. But that's going to be a dead abaddon. And here we have Spiritbreaker running for his life. 6 seconds on the charge. I think he'll be able to get away here.
And we had four heroes committed in mid, four heroes then just committed up top to only get one kill each time. It's still gives him a decent chunk of change complexity, but it's not nearly what they wanted. They wanted to be able to grab both of those kills because they TP'd while they were both underneath the tower. So, yeah, Mischief are losing heroes again. That's not good for them. But at the same time, we can file that one over somewhat acceptable casualties because, yeah, the Rubick went down, the Abaddon went down, but you've still got Sunbee farming in the mid lane, 5-0-4 as we mentioned, and IX Mike is still looking pretty strong as he's now diving up the top lane again, going onto Hanskin this time, and just it's not really diving so much as forcing them all back as a solo Abaddon against the tri-lane and securing some farm in the process.
Yeah, this is the playstyle I've seen from IX Mike throughout this entire qualifier, but hold that thought. We've got a charge here onto Hanskin. I don't think he's going to get his way out of this one. Oh, but they're going to go for the Nightmare right before the ultimate, but there's going to be the blink. There's the crush. Hanskin, you are out of luck, my friend. Spearbreaker getting another kill. And now here in the top lane, we've got poor little Z-Freak turtling for his life. I don't know if they know he's there, but Radiant, they are bloodthirsty. They're going to look for any kill they can get. Fortify being popped. Looks like TP out from Z-Freak, but easy tower going the way of Team Freedom, and that's going to open up the entire dire jungle for the Radiant heroes. Definitely an advantage you don't want to give away if you're complexity.
That was down the first tower of the game, too.
That was the
or
first
the
tower.
Second, rather.
Yeah,
the mid tower
went
down.
I'm pretty sure mid went down as well. Chess even taking a charge here, and I think Invoker tanky enough to handle it. He has his Midas, he's got some boots, and yeah, there's going to be a cancel on the charge. Not wanted to play with fire just yet.
I think his lack of support was the reason for that one. I mean, IX Mike and Fun were close behind him, but not close enough to directly follow up. So yeah, the charge would have connected. Oh wait, top Limp is being chased down by the Abaddon. The pings come out. IX Mike, it's just a zoning thing. Once again, forces them back under the tower. Even though he's not really doing all that much damage, there's still the constant threat of everyone else coming in. But now it's the bottom. The charge in on the Swindles. They'll go in. They've got the Death Ward. Even though he's got the Chrono, they've charged the Paralyzing Cast still being a big issue. He will get out. In the meantime, Z-Freak will get the first kill on the Sunbee. And now the chase is on. They're looking for more. They want this Chronosphere, but Fun is a little bit too far away. Maybe they can catch him on the back around, though.
Yeah, it looks like they're really gearing up. They want something here. All the Dire Heroes rotating in, and now gotta zoom out to catch all the action, as there's gonna be a full split out. Slardar squiggling away. Looks like he'll get away safely, but here, behind the tower, cute little Spirit Breaker might be in some trouble. Does have the charge away if he needs it, but this is just going to be a clean tower for complexity unless Radiant do something about it real soon. And what they're going to do about it is they're just going to look for a trade here. IX Mike, I am like an absolute madman here, smacking on the tier 2 all alone. Definitely his playstyle, just to go in, be aggressive, be a bully, and now TP out from the Spirit Breaker. They lose the bottom tower, which is a huge disadvantage in terms of keeping the jungle safe, but Radiant Heroes ready to posture up, maybe take this tower, but certainly just clean out the jungle and make it harder for Complexity to get the farm they need.
I'm really surprised that Mischief didn't end up fighting in that bottom lane. I think throughout this time, they felt like, yeah, sure, we've got a really strong lineup, but maybe they feel that their pickoff potential is a lot stronger than their team fight, which I can see the reasoning behind. The main point, though, is that you, as a lineup like this, giving away a tier 1 tower is a huge blow, because you don't want to be giving up anything. You just want to get straight fight wins and or one fights, get towers on your own, and Witch Doctor, one more tick is going to keep him alive. Okay, so he doesn't die, but still getting pretty close. Mid lane though, Chrono onto Kiko.
Yeah, it's going to be a Chrono committed. They really, really want this Spirit Breaker, and it takes all 5 on Complexity to secure the kill, and now Chrono. There's no way Ice Blast from the Ancient Apparition. Are Radiant gonna try to punish this? And it looks like Sunbee plopping down some wards, just getting some vision, gonna be farming up here. Does not care at all the Complexity to stop this teammate.
Yeah, this is really good for Complexity. It's now gotten way past the point of acceptable casualties. We've entered territory of, well, we're giving Complexity a lot of ground now. They got a tier 1 tower. They've been getting kills left and right. I mean, it was something like 12-4, now it's 12-8. Or, I mean, I might be being dramatic here, but in the end, though, Complexity have, in the past couple of minutes, been getting infinitely more objectives than Mischief, which is nowhere near what they've needed to make this lineup work. So they're going to try and go for a quick, sneaky Roshan. Seems like this could be the play, but the Forge Spirits are going to scout it out. And it's going to scout it at like 25% HP, so there's no real way they can stop this one. But they can fight as soon as the Aegis goes down. Maybe they can make it. Looks like IX Mike going to try to dole them as they come in with the Ancient Apparitions Ice Blast. It'll hit onto two, or at least looks like just Fange here, as they're going onto Limp, who can reincarnate, so he should be fine. The Roshan will go down, though. Deafening Blast, they still get the Aegis. Now we'll turn away onto Limp as Sunbee's in close by. They've got the Aphotic Shield. Turns around, will throw out the Magic Missile. They'll comes a time dilation. Now a Death Ward will connect on the Z-Freak, not kill him yet. Hanskin will drop to this one. No Swindles will grab himself a killing spree though, as he walks away relatively unscathed thanks to the time walk. For the setup of that fight, that was surprisingly low casualty.
Yeah, I thought it was going to be a full 5-on-5 engage, although we might not be done here. There's going to be a charge coming out onto Z-Freak. I think they can commit this under the Tier 2 tower. Looks like Spearbreaker going in. There's going to be a TP in from the Wraith King. Not have his ult just yet, and this might be punishing, as Chessie's here, Chessie's angry, and now, you know, getting very, very low. Swindle's going in, Time Dilation being cast. One more hit on the Spearbreaker. We'll secure it, but he might be getting away. Wraith King does not have that blink, but there's the Time Walk. Does blow anymore, kid, and now one Bash takes down the Aegis. I think they can secure a second kill here. And, that's easy kill.
Yeah, they got him through the Aegis, they got two lives of him. Complexity did lose a couple in that fight, but Swindle's just getting everything out of these fights. He's 4-0-1. I don't think we've talked about this yet. This Phaseless Void has not only died, but he also has a Hand of Midas. So his farming speed is going through the roof. Even though he's not the top worth right now, he will catch up to this one in no time at all. And off the back of that Hand of Midas, which had been in the past a really popular item.
I'm going to let you finish here, but Hand's getting in some trouble. Ice Blast coming in. It will connect onto Slardar. Nightmare being used in there, but Vengeful Spirit getting another kill here. 6, 2, and 5. Picking up the Sanj. Should be going into Sanj and Yasha very shortly. This carry Venge is getting kind of huge. In terms of net worth, she is top of the charts, followed up by her own Slardar. So Radiant definitely securing themselves an advantage, but I don't know if they can hold it. Z-Freak taking a charge here, but Spearbreaker, you might be in some unfriendly territory. Swap goes in, brings in Limp, no Reincarnate just yet, and Chrono's being committed, but I don't think Swindles has the damage here. And now Limp gonna be the target of the aggression, but Deafening Blast connects on 4. This is huge here, and Limp very, very low, trying to use that armlet toggle to keep him alive, but IX Mike, my goodness, we've seen that guy play crazy. Ice Blast off the mark. He could get nightmared up here. Don't think there's any follow-up, although Bane going in, trying to use the Brain Zap, does pop that, what's it called? Borrowed Time. I couldn't remember the name of that. Now there's going to be a Yule's up. Mineski Fangay going to be taking a Fiend's Grip here. It's like, so far, all the Radiant heroes are still alive, trying to desperately get out here. And I think they'll do so. There's going to be a TP out from Fun, and everyone else just running back to safety as Dire not able to get any picks.
And this is, like I was going to say before that fight broke out, there's nothing really stopping Mischief from just going in and going ham as 5, and that's what they did, except it was kind of weird. It didn't seem like they were gelling together all that well. They kept going in, the Slaughter would find a good initiation, and then something would screw them up. Most notably, that Chrono catching 4 of them when they tried to follow up. So Complexity is still giving themselves lots of space and lots of time to continue pushing this game closer and closer to the point where they can just run over Mischief. Hasn't quite hit it yet, and the power curve is starting to turn away a little bit. So right now it's gonna get to a point where it's about dead even as far as the team fight goes. Still, I don't think it's there yet, but with Chessie topping the net worth now and Swindles again nipping at the heels of everyone else. Okay, Chessie's not topping it now, but you get the point.
Very, very close. They've been swapping back close and forth for the last minute. And we're going to see a charge. Nope, Spearbreaker. I'm not going to go solo this time. Just going to go into the Dire Jungle and play dirty a bit. And Complexity, they're a little bit scared here. They have in the bottom lane. There's going to be Limp here, just securing some farm, but he does have a TP back if he needs it. And they might be needing this pretty soon as Radiant, they're going in full aggression onto this tower. There is a Fortify here on the Dire. They are going to pop it now, keeping the Tier 2 up. They think this is a really important objective, and they are right. Looks like IX Mike in some unfriendly territory. Going to be taking a Wraithfire Blast. He's all right, though. He's still got his borrow time if he needs it. Level 2. And now there's going to be a crush in. Mineski Fangay catching out Swindles. Swindles in some trouble here. Going to get nightmared up by a teammate. There's going to be an Ice Blast connects on 2. There's going to be a Chrono and a Sunstrike Deafening Blast to follow up. That's a double kill. Really nice work by Chessie so far, but the fight's not over. Chessie's still very healthy, although there's going to be a crush in. Connects on the Faceless Void. He's going down. Looks like Spearbreaker not able to strike a kill, but oh, the pop shield. It'll take down Ancient Apparition as well. Slardar trying to get out, doing the best he can. And so far, there's going to be a Reincarnate here from Limp. Mineski Fangay definitely wanting to get away, but might not be so lucky. And then Voka's going to get the kill on that as well. IX Mike trying to go for blood here. He's most likely dead as well. 20 seconds on the borrowed time cooldown. A couple more slashes from the Wraith King finishes it off. That's going to be a 4-for-2 on the side of Complexity. They are definitely the big winners there. My goodness.
Yep, and we talked about the power curve. Well, that's where I guess it's definitely in Complexity's favor now. It just, Team Mischief, for too long of a time, it seemed like they just weren't coming out as far ahead in fights as they needed to. And then we saw that kind of awkward engagement in the mid lane where they couldn't quite kill anyone despite going ham. And then, well, that happens. And of course, I am going to chalk that up to a little bit of misplay by Mischief. They didn't seem to solidify an initiation that they were all comfortable with. And that kind of lack of commitment by some of them really made the team fight a lot worse than it could have been. But in the end, the result is the same. Complexity will get a massive amount out of that fight. And of course, now we've got Chessy well off on the net worth chart. And even though Swindles is still a little behind, remember, he's got that Midas, so it doesn't have to be a super farmer to get a decent amount of gold and stay on par with that of Team Mischief. And he's doing a good job at least making par. But now we'll start to see his score rise a little bit, as it looks like Mischief are going to try to bully down the Tier 1 and Tier 2 bottom. Complexity, they seem to be calling the shots right now.
Yeah, we have 3 minus gaming going on, and I think that's going to be pretty nice in terms of taking this into the late game. Hold on one sec, there we go. And yeah, just like you said, going in, bullying down this tower. There's going to be really no rotations here by Plexity. They're fine to just trade this. They're going in for the mid tower. I think that's the right play. Tower's gonna fall. I don't think Complexity are gonna go in for anything else here. There's gonna be a walk out from the void, trying to dodge out any raid initiation. If they're gonna rotate in, they wanna save this mid tower, but oh, gonna be an immediate Chrono Sunbee. You might be out of luck here. Gonna be taking a Sunstrike to the face, and a nice blast finishes them off. But here we're gonna see Bane go down here to the Witch Doctor ward. And now, Seafreak, you're in a heap of trouble, taking the Spirit Breaker Bash. And oh, there could be some support in though. There's gonna be the meatball down here from Chessy on the Invoker, doing some serious damage. Taking down the Spirit Breaker. Now IX Mike in a heap of trouble. He's got his bar of time, but I don't know if that's going to save him. There's also Reincarnate by the Wraith King, so they have to bring him down not once, but twice. Looks like they'll take him down the first time, but IX Mike not going to be surviving this one now. There's going to be a blink in, stun up, Mineski Fangate trying to get away desperately, but triple kill for the Invoker. That is the power of Complexity's draft, and I think Mischief's window might be closing.
So I have been corrected. It is Team Freedom and not Mischief, apparently.
It's a new sponsor, and it takes a while for the Yoda in-client thing to correct itself.
So that is my bad. I am sorry to the fans who might be upset with me. But the end result here, Team Freedom or Team Mischief aside, they just got completely and utterly demolished.
There we go. Limp taking a stun and going to be taking a charge as well. Armlet toggle off, doing a lot of damage there. There's going to be a AA blast coming in. Definitely blast secures some serious damage. Sunbee is going to be going down. This is not the engage the Radiant wanted. They wanted a clean pick, and instead they're running for their lives. They lose their carry vent. Their Slardar is still down. I think Complexity are in a really nice position right now at the 24-minute mark.
That was beautiful. That was the most beautiful thing I think I've seen in my entire... Okay, no, it is not, but it's very close. That combo that they just pulled off here, of course, the Invoker ends up taking a huge chunk of that, but the Ice Blast also coming in the follow-up. They eradicated Sunbee, and we're almost able to get more. Now, it looks like Fangay, he wants to bring down Chessy, but unfortunately, his power curve is not quite enough to get it going. However, Kiko's gonna come in, turns around, gets the cool snap off. Now they'll turn and try to bring down Kiko, and they've got everything for him. They'll throw the Ice Blast and the Chronosphere down. He is dead. The Limp looks like he's gonna take a fall here. No Reincarnate, still a bit on cooldown, so he's gonna have to sit this one out for a short amount of time. Sunbee's in. We'll see if he can actually do any damage here. Z-Freak gets slapped across the face with a shell-topped staff, and we'll get brought down. So I guess I spoke a little bit too soon. Complexity not quite owning Team Freedom in every single fight. It looks like Team Freedom still showing signs of life, but in the end, Complexity do not lose that many. They'll lose two, and they'll be able to back themselves off in the next fight. Well, they'll have the Ice Blast again. They also will have the Reincarnate ready to go, and there's very little for Team Freedom to stop that Reincarnate from happening.
Yeah, take a look at the XP chart. Just Complexity keeping themselves farming. The double Midas strat certainly paying off, as there's a 10,000 XP advantage here.
Yeah.
That's sizable. That is certainly something you do not want to play up against if you're Team Freedom, which Alright, looks like Roche is going to be scouted out by the Dire. That could be something they want to rotate in, although IX, Mike, Vengeful Spirit, they're going to pose a serious gatekeeper's threat. Dire want to rotate here through this choke point on the map.
And it looks like Sunbeam might be going for this Aghanim Scepter buildup, which makes a lot of sense because he's been the one to die pretty much first in every fight. But we'll have to see if he's able to get it out in a timely fashion. His complexity, they're gearing up in the mid lane. If they smell something fishy, they will head towards the Roche pit, and they're going to smoke up and look for this one. Swindle's going to reveal, though.
Looks like Limp going to be blinking and trying to find something, although Mineski Fanke, he's got an Invis rune, and he's ready to go in. There's going to be a Chrono here as Swindle's trying to do what he can. There's a nice close-range Ice Blast connecting onto two. IX Mike might be going down here as well. His Borrowed Time not going to heal him up so hard, but Chessy, serious damage. IX Mike going down from the Fiend's Grip on the Bane. Now Chessy going to get nightmared up by his ally. Z-Freak going to be taking a charge to the face. Chessy gets bashed as well, but I don't think there's any vision. But oh, Chessy taking the turn. Bane getting the kill there using the Brain Suck. And Chessy finishing off a small camp just for style points before rotating into the Roche Pit.
Every Dota player's worst nightmare. To lose a fight that big, that close to the Roche pit. So they're going to lose that Aegis, and I think it's still an Aegis. It's still the second Roshan, if I'm not mistaken. So
yep,
it,
no cheese, yeah.
Yeah, not yet, but it's coming. If this game goes to another Roshan, which I'm not quite sure Complexity even need to let happen. Though there are still three Tier 2 standing, so I'm not sure they can end the game very soon. If they were to win another fight, it probably would just be GG. I don't think Team Freedom have all that much gas left in the tank. And that's to say these guys are showing a lot of life in some of these fights, and I won't count them out just because, yeah, they can. If they do find a mistake in Complexity's playstyle, they should be able to exploit it. But as it stands right now, Complexity are winning the majority of team fights, and Mischief, even if they start to come out strong in a team fight. We've seen it happen. They only pull out one or two. Whereas if Complexity get ahead in the team fight, they will very nearly, if not, wipe Team Freedom. So it's again, we go back to the draft here where Team Freedom, they had this lineup that pre 20, maybe 25 minutes would be strong. But once the game kind of went on a little bit, well, we start to see that become weaker and weaker as Complexity. Well, they've got a cap so much higher than what Team Freedom could even dream of right now.
Yeah, and again, whether it's for the double Midases, the one team fights, or just the fact that this is a more cohesive, long-range draft. Oh, here we go, Sunbeam, casting the Wave of Terror, trying to tease out something here. Swindle's going to be taking a missile to the face. Radiant Heroes rotate in. Think it might still made out unless there's gonna be a Chrono in from the Swindles. That's an Ags Chrono as well. Sunbee looks like she'll be fallen and is gonna go down. The first casualty so far. Spiritbreaker trying to go in, trying to make something happen before his untimely demise. There's gonna be a tornado up, catches two, and now this looks like a close range AA blast into Deafening Blast, and that is gonna be a super dead Spiritbreaker. Mineski Fangay, your BKB isn't gonna save you now. IX Mike using that Borrowed Time, trying to get something for this engage, but Swindles time walks up all the damage. Now IX Mike going in, getting very low. Fun gonna be following suit as well. There's gonna be an EMP to take away everyone's mana, and that's gonna be another kill. Fun gonna fall
that's
as
wipe.
Well. That's a wipe. Completely lose nothing in that engage except for some ultimates. Definitely a trade you're willing to take, and should Team Freedom just tap out right now? Get the XP and gold graph. It is over 20,000 XP in favor of Complexity. Gold, just about 10,000, and that's a huge lead. I don't think that Team Freedom have any way to get back in this. They can't go for pickups, they can't go for teamfights. They're getting strangled out. Their map advantage is pretty much gone. A Fortify's not going to save you now. There's going to be a Yule here. Vengeful Spirit taking some damage. Oh, Sunbee gets popped, and I think that could be game, and it will be Sunbee calling out the GG. Remember, this is game one of two. We are going to go in. There will be a rematch here as Mischief definitely trying to make sure that they have a shot to go to the Shanghai Major.
And I know we got to get into the next game soon, so I'll keep this one short, but there was a very classic use of time dilation that last fight. You got a hero like a Baden who needs to cast these spells? Well, time dilation kept them on cooldown throughout the entire fight, and we saw how that went down for them. So 16 fantasy points picked up by Chessy, 13.6 on Limp. Just goes to show you the amount of dominance these guys had, and very well played overall by Complexity. Weathering the storm, coming out kind